Old-timey chimney sweeps have been mythologized in film and in TV shows for decades. But the life of a chimney sweep was far from romantic. It was dirty, dark, and often deadly. Here's the sad and tragic truth of old-timey chimney sweeps. Apprenticeships were agreements that, in theory, allowed children to learn a trade, while the master tradesmen got some free labor. But according to Owl Cation, apprentice chimney sweeps were some of the most badly abused. Master chimney sweeps tended to choose a very specific type of child, the smallest and most underfed children, preferably those with no parents or parents who weren't exactly in the picture. According to Victorian children, those kids who weren't sweeps by apprenticeship were often orphans plucked off the streets, or they were downright kidnapped into slavery. And master sweeps wanted them young, very young. The youngest on record was just 3.5 years old. While most were 5 or 6 for a terrible reason, they were still small enough to fit in the chimneys, but they were old and tough, enough to give them a fighting chance to survive the ordeal.
I think a number 6 should clear it. Number 6!
Yes, Gov?
Get up there.
Yes, we said fit in the chimneys. While most countries in Europe used a mechanical contraption to help clean chimneys, in England, they just sent the kid up the chute to do it manually.
Remember what I told you?
Try not to die.
That's the spirit, yeah.
Let's talk about just what kind of chimneys Victorian-era apprentices were being sent into, because they were nothing like the straight single chimneys we think of today. Chimneys in the cities were often installed in old buildings, which meant that they were far from straight. They were typically angled to avoid cutting through living spaces, and most were around 9 inches by 14 inches in size, if they were lucky. It wasn't uncommon for chimneys to be only about 7 inches square, which is a tight squeeze indeed. Tight spaces and extreme angled corners weren't all sweeps had to deal with either. It wasn't uncommon for chimneys to be around 60 feet tall, so death from falling wasn't unheard of. And that's a fall either back down the chimney or off the roof once they got out. And here's one more horrible fact. Owl Cation says that flues were often connected, particularly at the top. The reason? A 1664 law that said any roof with more than 2 chimney tops was taxed extra, so they were often combined. The result was a labyrinth of chimneys that a sweep could get lost in, and they often did, because sweeps didn't just climb up the chimney, they had to climb back down. A wrong turn could be deadly, and so a sweep could lose their bearings and start down the wrong chimney right from the roof. Owl Cation says that complicated Victorian chimney systems built up soot quickly, and many needed to be cleaned as often as 4 times a year. It's not entirely surprising then to learn that a single chimney sweep might be responsible for cleaning not just 1 or 2 chimneys a day, but as many as 20. If children thought they were going to slow down and protest, they would be sorely mistaken, literally. Master sweeps had some definitely unpleasant ways of getting children to hurry up, and according to the local chimney sweep, that included carrying a sharp stick that was used to prod the feet of children who were hesitant about climbing. In fact, once they were out of stick range, it wasn't unheard of for a master sweep to just light a fire in the fireplace to encourage a child to work faster.
On the way and in the keep.
It's dark up here, Mr. Grimes.
Get your there. That's a light of fire and burn the broom.
Some bumps and bruises come with the territory when you're a kid, but it's tough to stress enough just how horrible the life of an apprentice sweep was. Owl Cation says that typically, sweeps in the country had it better than those in the cities, but those city kids? Life was awful, especially when they were just starting. While some masters would give their kids pads for their knees and elbows, others simply didn't bother, and sometimes the chimneys would be so narrow that they needed every bit of space they could get. This meant shedding their clothes and climbing naked, save a cap worn to keep the worst of the soot out of their face. Sounds painful? It was. If the chimney was hot, the master sweep would often stand on the roof. In case he heard the child screaming, he'd be there to pour water down the chimney. When the children emerged, their elbows and knees were often raw and bleeding. In order to toughen them up, the master sweeps would force the development of hard calluses by purposely scraping them with a stiff brush dipped in brine. And this treatment could be repeated for months or years before the calluses were thick. Other master sweeps would simply wash their wounds with salt water and then send them on to the next chimney. In spite of the fact that many master sweeps deliberately underfed their apprentices so they remained small, they could definitely get stuck, and they got stuck a lot. One slip could result in the child's legs getting trapped beneath them, wedging the apprentice in the chimney. If that happened, another apprentice was sometimes sent up to tie a rope around their legs and try to pull them out. But that risked the loss of two sweeps, and there are known instances of both boys dying inside the chimney.
Problem is, see, unlike, say, your screwdriver or your spanner, your chimney sweep has an annoying tendency of growing older and getting bigger.
Suffocation was a very real danger, too, either from falling soot or from becoming wedged too tightly in the chimney to be able to breathe. Burns were also a common cause of death, along with falling from rooftops.
The chimney sweep's busiest season was usually around the holidays, when people were preparing for Christmas parties, and the cold, damp weather played havoc with already aching joints with an even greater risk.
Think it can't get worse? It can. According to the local chimney sweep, when a child did die in a chimney, recovering the body sometimes meant breaking a hole through the wall and chimney, and that was up to the homeowner to decide whether or not they wanted to do it. Sometimes, a careless master wouldn't even notice their apprentice had gotten stuck or died, and the sweep would be left to starve or burn to death when the fire was lit. While it might be a given that being a chimney sweep is a dirty job, that's just the start of it. According to The Lancet, children working as apprentice sweeps weren't just often forced to climb 60-foot chimneys without even the protection of clothes. They would typically only bathe once a year.
Oh, it's awfully dark and gloomy up there.
There now, you see how wrong people can be? That there is what you might call a doorway to a place of enchantment.
Newsflash, Bert's lying. Being covered in soot and creosote 24/7 isn't just unhealthy, it's downright dangerous. By the late 1700s, doctors had identified a particular type of cancer common among chimney sweeps. First developing in the scrotum, this cancer would ultimately spread to the abdomen and cause an unthinkably painful death. The cause? The soot that inevitably became lodged in the folds of skin. By 1788, the problem had gotten so bad that Parliament passed a law stating that chimney sweeps should be no less than 8 years old and be bathed at least once a week. It didn't seem to do much good. By 1910, scrotal cancer was the cause of death listed for around 29% of chimney sweeps. And that was just the worst of the many health issues chimney sweeps faced. For starters, there were the immediate problems. Northeastern Chimney says that because children were put to work so young and forced to spend so much time in cramped spaces, they often grew disfigured as they matured. Their growth was often stunted, their joints were a constant source of pain, and vision problems were fairly constant too. Chronically sore eyes were on the better end of what they could hope for, and some eventually went blind from the soot particles. According to Owl Cation, many also suffered from chronic respiratory troubles, often developing breathing problems so severe they became deadly, particularly when the weather turned cold. Then there was the chance of developing a fungal infection in the lungs called histoplasmosis. The source? The birds and their droppings that were around in only slightly smaller quantities than the soot. Then there were the long-term problems, the ones that didn't show up for a while. London's Pulse Projects found that chimney sweeps suffered from abnormally high rates of lung, esophageal, and liver cancer, along with leukemia and mesothelioma.
If there was ever an unlikely-sounding uniform for a chimney sweep, it's the top hat and tails. But in old photos, so many of them seem to be wearing this dapper sort of dress. What's up with that?
Bond's chimney sweeping claims there are actually a few stories associated with sweeps' preference for such fancy clothes, with one oft-repeated tale going back to King George II. He was riding his horse when it was spooked by a dog, and a quick-witted sweep grabbed the reins and calmed the panicked animal. By way of thanks, the king decreed that sweeps were allowed to wear top hats, a right usually reserved for the upper class. It's uncertain just how true that is, but there's another story that seems a bit more believable. Being a chimney sweep was dirty work, and people tended to look down on the people who did that sort of thing. In order to raise their profile and make them a little more respectable, the story goes it was decided that chimney sweeps would start adopting the super stylish combination of the top hat and black coat. Regardless of how it happened, it wasn't long before it was tradition. Most chimney sweeps would have worn something of the sort, and it was a practical tradition too. The suit blended right in. chimney sweeps have a reputation as being lucky, to the point where if you were one, you could probably pick up some extra cash with a side gig of just, well, being good luck. According to Midtown Chimney Sweeps, there are a few legends that account for the sweep's lucky image. For starters, there's the legend that says a sweep saved the life of William the Conqueror and was invited to his daughter's wedding. This is completely untrue, of course. In fact, houses at the time didn't have chimneys that needed sweeping, so there was no such profession as a chimney sweep yet. Another story tells the tale of a sweep who fell off a roof and was dangling from a gutter when he was rescued by a fair maiden who pulled him into her window. They fell in love and ended up getting married, and if that's not lucky, what is? As there's a wedding in both of those stories, it's not surprising that it's long been said to be good luck to have a chimney sweep at your wedding, and some sweeps were hired specifically to attend weddings. It's also said that after a sweep has cleaned your chimney, it's good luck to touch his buttons, kiss him, or blow him a kiss, as they say in Mary Poppins, or to just shake his hand. Chimneys began appearing around the 12th century, but it wasn't until the 16th century that chimney sweeping became an actual job. It still wasn't widespread, though, until the Great Fire of 1666 destroyed a large part of London, which spurred the need for professionals to make sure it didn't happen again. By the 18th century, chimney sweeps as we know them were common in England, but they were also completely unregulated. It wasn't until 1834 that the Chimney Sweeps Act was passed to try to stop the widespread abuse that most apprentice sweeps labored under, forbidding the apprenticeship of children under 10. The problem? There really wasn't anyone employed to monitor the industry. It quickly became clear that there were still widespread abuses within the industry, and another act was passed in 1840 that was supposed to issue more protections, but even Parliament says that it really didn't. There was yet another law enacted in 1864, but it wasn't until 1875 that all chimney sweeps were required to be licensed, and this time, it was enforced by police. The good news? Mary Poppins is set in 1910. Meaning that Bert probably apprenticed after those safety laws had been enacted, so he should be okay, assuming he avoids that scrotal cancer. Good luck, Bert. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.